Okay, welcome everyone at the Advanced Materials Forum. Good afternoon to everyone here in Geleen, and good morning to everyone dialing in on the webinar. During the next hour or so, I will try to explain you something about fatigue of engineering plastics, where we'll try to highlight the basics and some modeling aspects. And you might appreciate it, although I will be presenting, of course, these are efforts for me and a lot of co-workers, even with some contributions from my PhD time at the University of Eindhoven. This is the outline of the presentation. So first I want to start with a small introduction to DSM and DSM R&D. Then I will highlight some fatigue, the basics, and I will introduce you to the Goodman diagrams. Eventually I will discuss a bit on the failure mechanisms that cause failure in engineering plastics and give you some trends and some general understanding. Then I would like to highlight the effect of viscous heating and self-heating, and I would like to give you a glance at our approach to do lifetime predictions on part performance. So first introduction on DSM R&D. So DSM has a corporate R&D entity, which is the DSM Material Science Center, which is a corporate R&D department which with approximately 400 employees, of which 350 people are scientists or technicians, all with a dedicated expertise. We dare to say that we're quite diverse, and we're based on two different sites. So the majority of the people are located in Geleen, and we have a smaller department in Shanghai. And our main customers are the different business groups within DSM. So you can think of DSM Engineering Plastics, DSM Dyneema, Resin and Functional Materials, Biomedical, or Additive Manufacturing. The DSM Material Science Center is a competence-based R&D unit, so that means that we try to maintain and invest on different competencies that we need to answer the questions from the business. So if you take engineering plastic as an example, you can imagine that if you want to make a polymer, you need to know something about polymer chemistry. Next step, if you have a polymer and you want to make something out of it, you're going into polymer processing. So you need to do compounding and injection molding, so you need a certain competence group that knows a lot about these things. Eventually, if you can make something, then you want to break it, so that is where mechanics come in. And eventually, you would also think of, let's say, do real part simulations, so CAE computations on the real parts. So this is just a glance at specific competences, but it tells you how you want to maintain this map to be able to answer and help the businesses as well as you can. This brings me to me. So I'm a scientist in a mechanics competence group. I joined DSM slightly more than 4 years ago. I have a background in polymer technology, so I have a PhD in lifetime predictions, so I worked a lot on trying to predict long-term performance using short-term experiments. And that got me involved in different topics at DSM, comprising, for example, wear and friction of gears, fatigue of engineering plastics, which I will present today, and some work on continuous fiber reinforced composites. Something more personal. So people in Europe will probably already know, I live and work in the Netherlands. It is a small spot in Europe. And if you zoom in, you can see that my activities are mainly concentrated in the south because I used to study in Eindhoven. I live in Weert, which is slightly below, and now I actually go more down south to work in Geleen. So now it's time for content. So on fatigue. So first, I would like to introduce you to our approach on fatigue and predictability. Because I think, since we're competence-based, we try to target fundamental understanding of time-dependent failure. So you could think of this from a material side. As you think of, okay, how do you characterize your material? How do you know the performance of your grades or your specific materials that you have? And eventually, if you know this, how to measure this, or what is affecting what, then you can also use this for material improvement. Eventually, you will also go to structural level, because every customer is interested in really making parts out of this. And that's why you would like to improve predictability. And eventually you want to predict the lifetime during application. So that involves complex loading situations where both the frequency, load amplitude, and maximum load oscillate. Of course, all is interconnected, because if you can characterize your material better, you will also be better in predictability. And if you improve your material, then of course in application level, you're also performing better. So in this presentation, I will try to target the first two. So the first part will be on material characterization, which is a major portion. And then a few slides will still discuss our attempts to improve predictability of parts. First, I would like to start with some take-home messages. So I think, hopefully, everyone after this presentation realizes that loaded plastics will display time-dependent failure. Goodman diagrams, which I will introduce in a second, are an easy tool to include the influence of load amplitude or mean stress sensitivity. There are different failure mechanisms that you have to take into account. Krekerud-controlled failure and plasticity-controlled failure, and accelerated testing might lead to misinterpretation of results. Last but not least, if you then do understand what you're doing on this level, then you can also model the failure mechanisms, and that will also enable you to do more accurate predictions, but also to do more with less experiments. So first of all, what is fatigue? Well, I think everyone knows the picture on the top. And if you then look into the definition of fatigue, then you go to the engineering's best friend, you look it up on Wikipedia. If you do this, then you find this definition, which tells you something about fatigue is weakening of a material by repeatedly applied loads. You have some progressive and localized damage. Some cyclic loading is mentioned there. Something about the nominal maximum stress values, and maybe much less than the strength of the material. So it has certain specific phrases, and although I don't agree with all, so for example, weakening and repeatedly damage and cyclic loading is not necessarily the case. But I think especially the last sentence is key, because it tells you something that loaded polymers will eventually display time dependent failure, but even at stress levels far below the short-term strength. And to highlight this, I have an example from the university, where they loaded a polycarbonate cup with a static strength of approximately 37 kilonewtons. You load it just slightly below that value. And then on the right, you can see the movie running what will happen. So with a constant load of 35.5, you see small elastic response, then gradually creep, and then it starts to collapse. And you measure a lifetime up to 10 to 10.5 seconds. You can do the same thing, but a load even lower, so even further below the short-term strength. And what you then see is something similar. So you can see the initial elastic response, slightly slower creep deformation, slowly deforming and compressing the cup, and eventually, again, it collapses. So now the load is a bit lower, so the time to failure is a bit longer, but you can see that already at these loads, which are still well below the short-term strength, you see some time-dependent failure. You can do this for a lot of different load levels, and I will not bother you with all the movies, because please appreciate the log scale. This would mean that the presentation would take more than a day. But it tells you that you can already see time-dependent failure at these loads, well below the short-term strength, and the trend is trivial. If you have a high load, then you will have short failure times, and if you have a low load, then you will have longer failure times. So if you want to know how your part performs, let's say if this cup would be a real part, if you want to understand how it performs, then one thing you want to do is find out how this trend works. What is the slope of this line? What is the force or stress dependency? So this brings me to typical fatigue testing capabilities, because the easiest way to find out is just by measuring. So on the left, you can see a fatigue machine. On top, you have a moving actuator. In between, you have a temperature chamber in case you want to control environmental conditions. You have some two grips, which are then clamping the specimen, here highlighted in red. And then what you do is you just load it, and you measure the lifetime until failure. And sometimes you also interrupt the test and you measure the residual strength, but to be honest, we already do that at this moment. Depending on the materials, you want to have a certain loading range. So you have 2.5 to 100 kilonewtons, depending on what kind of material or sample you're looking for. You can play around the temperature, from very low temperatures to very high temperatures. You can apply a certain waveform, and you can play around with the frequency. Looking at the waveform, then the first thing you have to realize is that you can, of course, define or fix this waveform by several parameters. So besides frequency, you can define the load signal by, let's say, the mean stress or load amplitude, by, let's say, the minimum or the maximum stress. We decided, as is also very common in this field, to use the maximum load and the so-called load ratio. So this load ratio R is defined as the minimum stress divided by the maximum stress. So that means if it's equal to 1, that means that the minimum stress is equal to the maximum stress, and that means that you just have a creep load, you just have a static load. If you then start decreasing the minimum load, that means it becomes smaller than the minimum than the maximum stress, and therefore the R value drops. So let's say for R is 0.1, that means that the minimum stress is only 10% of the maximum stress, or in other words, you're oscillating between, let's say, 100 megapascals or 10 megapascals. If you decrease the minimum load even more, and it becomes even in compression, that means that this stress becomes negative, and therefore also the R value changes sign, so you get an R value below zero, and this is called tension compression fatigue. If you then decrease the maximum load as well, and it also becomes a compression, something interesting happens, because then the R value becomes bigger than one, so you have compression fatigue. So I don't ask you all to just remember these R values by heart, but just realize that with this factor, you can define different regions. So you can define a region where you have purely tension, you can have a region where you have tension-compression, and you have compression-compression, and also this magnitude tells you something about the amplitude or the oscillation that you're applying. So if you then choose a certain R value that you want to apply, that usually should mimic your application, then the simplest thing to do is just apply a certain maximum stress, or force, because you use usually nominal values, and then just apply this load signal. And then eventually you just take the fatigue life as the number of cycles or the time, because that is the space we live in, at a specified cyclic load. And you can, of course, imagine the time to failure and cycles to failure are interchangeable. That will become clearer at a later stage. And in this example, this is a polyamide 6 with various composition, measured at room temperature, 1 Hz, RS 0.1, which is a typical loading range GC for these kind of tests. Then you look at the maximum stress plotted versus the fatigue cycles, and you just see a certain trend. And this example shows you that, let's say, for 140 megapascals, you can expect a lifetime of approximately 2,000 cycles. Whereas if you then look at the green one, something strange happens because somehow you end up with a lifetime which is more than a factor of 4 better. So these are typically the things that you want to do. But if you do this on a tensor bar, then you're still far away from the real applications. Because what I just showed were results on the left. You have uniaxial fiber orientation and a uniaxial loading condition. But eventually you want to use that to develop material models, probably also to generate material data, and then eventually to define certain failure criterion. And then in the end, you would like to predict the real performance of this part, where you include glass fiber orientation, but also, let's say, complex things like multiaxial stress and multiaxial loading conditions. So if you then zoom in on these realistic loading characteristics, I used a demonstrator bar that we use for validation bars here. Then let's say on the right top, you can see this is this part mounted in the Y direction, and you can just apply a certain load, cyclic load, by pulling and pushing on this end part. Then you can compute the stress levels. And that result is something you can see in over there on the right bottom. And it tells you, okay, I have a certain local stress with a certain magnitude, and I would like to look at that load and also the load amplitude distribution over that part to translate this towards a certain lifetime distribution. However, unfortunately, the performance is also highly dependent on fiber orientation. So depending on the processing conditions, you also have to take that into account. So the real question is, how can you then estimate the lifetime of all these different locations as function of the load amplitude or the maximum load, the local load ratio, the fiber orientation? And in reality, this is in the simplest case, but in reality, you will also have a fluctuating amplitude, maximum stress, and frequency in time. So in reality, you should also just have the time to failure as function of the frequency and all these things that vary in time. So that's why I want to introduce you to the so-called Goodman diagrams. So one trick to represent SN graphs is to go to a Goodman plot. So this is an example of data from a paper where they measured on composite materials. So you might be surprised for the load levels for engineering plastics, but this is because it's a composite epoxy system. And what they do is they just apply a certain load ratio and they measure the fatigue. So similar like the curves I showed before. And you get this specific trend for RS 0.1 for this type of material. Then if you have these data points, you can fit a suitable trend. So you can choose for a Lin-log or log-log plot, but at least you just fit a certain trend that is suitable for this experimental data set. What you then can do is you can determine stress levels that result in a specific lifetime. So that's a bit of a step, but you use this suitable trend that you have to estimate the stress level that results in a certain lifetime, like, for example, this 10 to the power 7. Because it tells you if you want to have a lifetime longer than 10 to the power 7 cycles, you can apply a load of, let's say, 500 MPa. If you know the maximum load that results in this lifetime, you can also recompute the load amplitude and the mean stress, as you can see on the right top of this graph, and you can plot these against each other. And this is what you now can see here on the right, and this is also what they call a so-called Goodman diagram, where you represent the data on the left on a mean stress versus stress amplitude plot. So if you do this, then for RS 0.1, you get a certain straight line, of course, because it's just a ratio between load amplitude and mean stress. But what you can do with the data on the left is that you can also plot these stress levels that result in a certain lifetime. So this is done over here, as you now can see. The circles on the top represent the shortest lifetime of 10 to the power 3, and the solid triangle on the bottom represents the lifetime of 10 to the power 7. And you just get a certain trend. What is now key? Well, you have to measure a lot, because you can also do this for other R values. This is RS10, which is RS 0.1 in compression, and you can see that you get a similar trend. And the reason why I use this example is because these guys really, really did a lot. So they used like 11 different R values, if I'm not mistaken. And you can already see more or less the trend that you're going to use, because you can see a lot of similar markers at different load levels. So you can start reconnecting these, as you can see over here. And that means you're defining certain ISO or continuous life regions. Because it tells you that if you follow this line, then all the stress levels or stress amplitudes below this line will still give you a lifetime longer than 10 to the power 7. So you can use this as a design trick. Let's say you have an application where the mean stress is approximately 300 MPa. It tells you that you can apply a certain load of 200 MPa without having failure before 10 to the power 7 cycles. So that's convenient. You can use this for designing. But the problem is that you still have to measure a lot, because I will highlight this, that you have the different regions. Here on the right, you can see the tension, in the middle, the tension compression, and on the left, compression. So it tells you something in what region am I designing. But if you then are using it for a real design tool, as you can see in this specific example, you can use it to estimate the current lifetime. So you can see here on the left, just an example that I took from the internet, which is some kind of bracket and suspension. What you can see is you have some hotspots at certain regions. So let's assume you take this top region where you have the maximum stress, so the red region, and let's say the sigma max is here 350 MPa. But since you're probably loading and unloading it, depending whether you push or pull, you can imagine that the real load ratio there would be RS 0.1. So if you then plot it in the Goodman diagram, you end up with this mean stress and stress amplitude, and it would give you the estimation that the lifetime would be somewhere at 10 to the power 10. So more or less, you know, don't have any failure at short times. If you do this also for another region, you could also imagine that here in this green region, the loads are lower because the color is different, so the stresses are lower. But since you're continuously pulling and pushing this region, you can imagine that this is actually RS minus 1. So you have a maximum load of 200 MPa, a load ratio of RS minus 1, and if you then plot it here in this graph, you can see that you're actually much closer to this 10 to the power 7. So instead of the very long lifetime that you see in this hotspot where you have the maximum stress region, you actually see failure at a different region. So from this you can conclude two things, I think. I hope that it shows that the Goodman diagram is a valuable tool, because by having this plot, you can just look at how safe am I and how should I perhaps also tailor my design. But it also tells you that the maximum stress location is not per se a failure location. So you have to look at both stress and load ratio to properly predict lifetime. But then, as I mentioned, you still have to measure a lot. You have to do a lot of different SN curves. So the question is, do we understand the effect of load ratio on the fatigue performance? Because then you can also model it. And then you can also end up with a prediction of this Goodman diagram instead of just measuring all these different R values and all these different lines. So I hope I tackled at least the first two take-home messages. So I hope the cup showed you that plastics will show time-dependent failure. And I hope that the Goodman diagram showed to be a valuable tool to develop and to use. Next will be the failure mechanisms, because you need to understand those to also predict the R-value dependencies. This is just to pose a fact. If you have long-term failure, you will see multiple failure mechanisms. So if you look at the log applied load, first log time to failure or cycles to failure, you usually see a region with a very flat slope, which is called plasticity-controlled failure. And at longer times, a lower load, you will find a region with a steeper slope, which is called crack growth-controlled failure. This originates from a long history in pipe testing, but this is also valid for different materials, as I can show you in a second. So this is some shameless self-citation and a paper where we demonstrate this phenomena for a lot of different systems. And here I just took four, which are two unreinforced materials, so just pristine matrix, and two glass fiber reinforced materials. And you can see overall, for all these cases, you can see this flat region and the steeper region coming in, and they also do something with amplitude, as I will explain in a second. The only problem is that in previous slide, I called this plasticity controlled and crack growth controlled, but you could also see some different shapes. You could also see that one of them was much more local deformation and the other one was relatively brittle. But in reality, if you go to glass fiber filled systems, the microscopic deformation mode no longer allows you to distinguish between these two failure mechanisms. So you have to know something else. What is then determining whether you have either very local plastic strain accumulation or very local crack growth or crack propagation? So I think at that moment you need to really understand the mechanisms that drive this time dependency, and then you can also study it and properly model the R-value dependency of these mechanisms. So back to these multiple mechanisms, focusing on plasticity-controlled failure and crack growth-controlled failure, and we'll first explain the basics behind crack growth-controlled failure. So as you all might know, is that if you have a certain imperfection or a certain, let's say, impurity in your material, then you will have a huge stress concentration in your material. Behind this stress concentration, you will form a certain craze, and this one will be bridged by fibrils, and these fibrils are still load-bearing. So due to this load, these fibrils, or these, let's say, fingers of material, will gradually deteriorate, and then the crack will advance or propagate. And then if the crack is sufficiently large, let's take this pipe as an example. As soon as the crack is reaching the outside of the pipe, you will have leakage. So as the crack reaches a certain critical length, you will have failure. So this is also something that, you can measure or model. So for example, to measure crack length or crack propagation, you usually use optical techniques or compliance techniques to measure the evolution of the crack as function of time, as you can see on the left. Depending on the load and on the crack length, you can define a certain magnitude of the load, what they call the stress intensity factor, but it will not go into much detail there. And by looking at the derivative of this line, you can say something about how much does this crack propagate if I apply a certain load. This is already quite well known, it's also quite old. So here on the left, you can see this from a paper already in the early 80s, so even before I was born, where people did this on a rather poor polyethylene pipe grade. So they measured this crack propagation rate on these compact engine specimens. On the x-axis, it's no more than just the load that you apply. And they did this for different temperatures, and you can see nice linear relationships on log-log. What it also tells you is, okay, with increasing temperature, you can see that the crack propagation rate increases. And it tells you something of, okay, how much sensitivity of the crack propagation rate do I see as function of the load, which is here plotted on the x-axis. You can imagine if you then go to a part and you know what the imperfection or the crack size is and the load is, you could also calculate how fast that small imperfection will start to grow. So if you do this iteratively, you can also compute how this crack will evolve as function of time. So you can simply calculate how long it will take until it causes functional problems. So this is what they did for these pipes here on the right. So you can see the hoop stress, so the stress in the circumferential direction for this pipe as function of time to failure. And they used the crack propagation rates measured on the left together with the assumption of a certain initial flaw to predict the part life of these pipes. And this was for static load, but they were happy enough, I think, to have a very poor pipe grade, because here you can see crack rate controlled failure already after, let's say, 10 to the power 6 seconds, which equals 10 days. In reality, if you look at current pipe grades, you will really have to wait longer than, I think, 2.5, 3 years to really see something. So even within 1.5 years of testing, you don't see any crack growth. So you have to perform different tricks. And that is what people usually know as fatigue loading. That's where the cyclic nature comes from. You apply a cyclic load to accelerate crack propagation. So if you might recall, the load is defined by this R value. So the smaller the R value, the larger the load amplitude is. And then if you basically apply this cyclic load, what you then will do is that at this crack where you have the fibrils or these fingers of material carrying the load, you will basically stretch and compress these fibrils continuously. So depending on the load, this effect is stronger and softer. So basically with the larger load, you deteriorate the fibrils faster and therefore also your crack advances more or faster. So this is something you can see here on the right or illustrated with these movies. For RS1, you don't see anything happening at all. So crack propagation is really, really slow. But if you then increase the amplitude, or therefore decrease the load ratio, you can see that you start to accelerate crack propagation, and the smaller the load ratio, the faster the crack propagates. So you can really achieve fast crack propagation rates, or strongly accelerate crack growth in the cyclic loading. As I mentioned, failure occurs once this crack reaches a certain critical length, so the influence on time to failure is also trivial. If you increase the amplitude, you will also reach the critical length causing functional problems earlier, and therefore lifetime decreases. And that is schematically shown over here. So here you can see the typical trend for time to failure and a crack growth controlled regime. If you compare the large R values to smaller R values, or if you lose low amplitudes with larger amplitude, you can see lifetime significantly decreases with increasing amplitude. So now back to the general picture. If you then look at plasticity controlled failure, it's actually a bit different. So plasticity controlled failure is known, probably better known as creep or creep rupture, because what happens is the stress that you apply induces a certain molecular mobility in the material. And because of this mobility and the stress, you just get a certain flow and the material starts to deform. Well, deformation cannot occur indefinitely, so eventually this leads to failure. That's what you see here on the left. So if you look at the evolution of strain as function of time, this case for a simple material polycarbonate with different applied loads, you can see that depending on the load, you will see for the higher loads, a higher creep rate. And since the material cannot deform indefinitely, it reaches this critical length or a critical amount of plastic strain earlier, and therefore you see a decrease in lifetime at increasing maximum load. To zoom a bit in on this, this critical length, I will introduce this concept of critical strain. Because if you look at this creep curve, or the shape of this creep curve, but now on a linear x-axis, then you can define different regions. So initially you see a small region where the strain gradually increases, but the decreasing rate. This is called primary creep. After that, you will find a region where you have a constant plastic flow rate, here defined as this epsilon dot plastic, which is called secondary creep. If you then continue straining, and eventually you see some acceleration due to some intrinsic or geometrical softening, and eventually this leads to failure. The funny thing is, if you know would look at the lifetime and the dysplastic flow rate, then if you just multiply the lifetime with the dysplastic flow rate, you can compute some kind of, let's say, plastic amount of plastic strain that would have been accumulated if this would really be the case. If the material would deform with this constant plastic flow rate for its entire lifetime, what would then be the amount of plastic strain that I would have? Why would you do so? Well, the convenient thing is, if you do this for different loading conditions, the only thing that changes is this rate at which it creeps. But this critical length, which triggers failure, apparently is the same. So this phenomenological observation already helps you, because it tells you something how to compute the lifetime. Because the only thing that you need to know is this critical length, so how much deformation can I allow before it fails, and you need to know the speed at which it deforms. And this is purely mobility driven, so it's just a function of stress, and this is something you can model. So this is for static loading. If you then go to cyclic loading, what you then can imagine is that since the stress is oscillating, also the mobility in the material is also following the same fluctuation. So if you apply a static load, you have a high stress all the time, high mobility, and therefore the high plastic deformation rate. But if you then apply a cyclic load, then also this mobility, as you can see over here, will also follow the same trend. Why is that important? Well, I mentioned that the only thing that you need to know is how long it takes until you reach this critical length. So you can just compute this time by just integrating the plastic flow rate as function of time, and simply just adding up the amount of steps of plastic strain that you see per cycle, and then just compute how many cycles it takes until you reach this critical length. So in reality, it looks like this. So on the right, you can see the accumulated plastic strain for a static load, so a high stress and therefore also a high overall plastic flow rate, and you reach this critical length at a very short time. When you apply a cyclic load, you could see that the mean stress lowers, and that also means that the overall plastic flow rate, which goes stepwise because of this sinusoidal sign, but the overall or the average plastic flow rate is much lower, and therefore it takes much longer before you reach this critical length. So this would suggest that in cyclic load, you would expect delayed failure, or at least failure at a later time with the same maximum applied load. And of course, there's also evidence for that. So here on the right, you can see an example for polycarbonate again, where you have the maximum stress plotted versus time to failure for static load. And you can see that indeed, for cyclic loads, the lifetime increases due to this decreasing rate of plastic strain accumulation. So in this case, a cyclic load has a longer time to failure. So I hope that you now also realize that there's something strange is happening, because I just showed for crack rate control that lifetime significantly decreases with decreasing amplitude. Whereas for plasticity control, actually, the decrease in mean stress or the decrease in plastic strain rate actually causes an increase in lifetime. So you have some counterintuitive trends. You can see at this region, lifetime decreases, or at higher stress levels, you can see a lifetime increasing with decreasing amplitude. Well, then the next thing that you might wonder is, okay, what does then frequency do? For crack rate control, this is trivial, because there's simply the amount of opening and closing. So how fast do you deteriorate these fibrils or these polymer fingers at the crease tip? But for plasticity control failure, it's a bit different, because it's just only driven by the accumulation rate that you see as a result of the mean stress, if you want. So if you don't change frequency, the only thing that happens is this size of step that you accumulate per cycle. But since you also have less cycles, you will also see something strange, because for a certain frequency, you see this trend that I just showed you. And if you then divide the frequency by 3, you can see that the step increases, but the overall average of these things, so let's say the average accumulation rate, doesn't change. And also, if you multiply by 3, then you can also see that still the average plastic flow rate is constant. So that also means that the time to failure is also independent of frequency. Whereas I just mentioned that for crack rate controlled failure, it's just it should scale with frequency. So to highlight this, this is an example also from Eindhoven University, showing you for an applied load signal where you have a sawtooth with a certain delta sigma. So here they controlled the amplitude and they kept the mean stress constant. And they just plotted lifetime for different load amplitudes. So you can see 5 MPa, of course, results in a higher lifetime, because also the maximum stresses are lower than 10 MPa. And this is all shown for 1 Hertz. If you then include data, or first the trend line, but if you then include data for 2 Hertz, you can see actually everything completely overlaps for both load amplitudes. If you then go to 5 Hertz, then still for the 5 Hertz, the time to failure, for the 5 MPa, the time to failure is really independent of the frequency that you apply. For the 10 MPa, you can see some minor deviations, and they become even bigger if you go to 10 Hz. But again, for the 5 MPa, you can see that everything is really independent of frequency. The reason why you see some deviation at the 10 MPa is simply because you get some viscous heating, but I will highlight this in after this part of the presentation. So given isothermal conditions, I think it's fair to say that the time to failure is independent of frequency, simply because it's the mean stress that is driving it, and not the cycles that it sees. But this is strange, because everyone working in fatigue is actually used to looking at SN curves, which means stress versus cycles. So actually, if you plot that, then you actually have a mechanism where lifetime increases, or the number of cycles to failure increases with frequency, which is very counterintuitive, because usually everyone says, frequency doesn't matter, it's just the number of cycles to failure that determine this. But actually, this failure mechanism tells you that in some ranges, this might not even be true. So if you then look at trends versus time to failure, in summary, I think what you then know is that if you look at the time to failure versus the maximum applied load, then as long as it's isothermal, you see a frequency-independent plasticity-controlled failure regime, and you can see a lifetime decreasing region for the crack rate-controlled failure, simply because you just open and close the crack tip multiple times per second. And if you then plot it versus cycles to failure, you can see the opposite trend. It's more or less constant for the crack rate controlled region because it's just the number of openings and closings. And for plasticity controlled failure, you see it scaling because of the mean stress sensitivity. Now the question arises, okay, why do we really bother about all these failure mechanisms? And therefore, I would like to highlight this issue or stress this short-term versus long-term testing. Because the thing is, if you look at RS1, which is just a static load, very long testing, you can usually see this plasticity controlled and crack rate controlled failure. But I just showed you, depending on the R value, you might also see these ranges for the different R values. So what would be interesting is to also incorporate the different timescales, as you can see now over here. So on the left, you can see 1 second, so not interested at all for long testing. And on the right, you can see 10 to the power 8, which is now 1,000 days. So to highlight this a bit, 10 to the power 6 is 10 days, 10 to the power 7 is 100 days, 10 to the power 8, 1,000 days. But in reality, if you want to start testing these kind of things, you don't want to perform tests of 100 days. So you're always performing accelerated tests. That means that you go up in load, and you go up in usually also frequency or temperature, trying to accelerate these things. So if you then also plot the practical testing times over this graph, then you can see that actually depending on the range of R values, you might just see one or two failure mechanisms. So in this example, RS minus one is fully dominated by crack rate controlled failure. RS 0.1 actually sees both. So you see a small range of crack rate controlled at longer times. And for RS one, you see only plasticity dominated failure. But if you then zoom in on the longer-term performance, you can actually see that for all the R values, the long-term performance will be limited by the crack rate controlled failure. So you have to be aware of the fact that although you might not see it on short-term, it will still be there on the longer-term. And you also need, if you want to study the R value dependency, also keep this in mind. Because for the R value dependency, you want to look at this line shifting to the right instead of that line shifting slope. So I hope that this also takes the third take-home messages. I hope that I introduced you to the different failure mechanisms. Also highlighted that you should be aware of these. The next thing would be the viscous heating or the self-heating effect. Because what I showed you is the trend in cycles to failure. And then I often get the comment that people don't recognize or they don't see this frequency effect that I mentioned. And that mainly has to do with either you're looking at a different failure mechanism or you're just self-heating the sample. Because you can imagine the polymer is just a viscous material. So if you start oscillating or stressing it, you also dissipate heat or dissipate energy, which expresses this as heat formation and therefore also heat up of your sample. So this is shown over here on the left. So here you can see the fatigue cycles or the stress versus strain cycles from fatigue load of 80 megapascals at 140 degrees at RS 0.1. And what you can see that initially you have more or less a fairly linear elastic response, but eventually you see that all these lines shift to the right. That means that you get some strain accumulation or some creep. And you can also see this loop, which means that this area underneath this loop is basically telling you something about how much energy you are dissipating. So you can see that as a function of time, you can see that you have gradually increase in strain and you continuously generate heat or energy that expresses itself in heat. And to highlight this, you can see on the right the temperature measured by sticking a thermocouple on the tensile bar. You can see that in this case, is 80 MPa is this yellowish orange line. You can see that there, although you set the environmental temperature at 140 degrees, the local temperature easily rises up to 155 degrees until the sample suddenly fails. So because of this frequency, which in this case was 8 hertz, you're actually just really heating up your sample, and therefore you're not measuring at the environmental temperature that you think. So you can see that the sample temperature is much higher than the environment. But I think more importantly, as you can see over there on the right, the sample temperature will also depend on the applied load that you have. So the higher the load, the higher the sample temperature will be. So to emphasize this a bit, I have a infrared movie of a small tensor bar, where on the top you can see the grips. I will see whether I can use pointer. On the top and the bottom you could see the grips. And in the middle you have a sample. And you can already see more or less a hotspot there, but you can notice the axis. So this is the maximum stress in the sample. Environmental temperature is approximately this 21 degrees. So this hotspot is exaggerated a lot. R value is 0.1 and the frequency is only 0.1 hertz. So it's really, really slow. But you can still see you're always generating some heat there in this hotspot. And like this, what you can see is near the end. You can see that this hotspot evolved to a much higher temperature. It's now already, I would say, 6-7 degrees above the environmental temperature. And even if you continue close to failure, you can see it really localizes that region. And then eventually when it fails, you can see it goes up sky high because of the viscous nature of the material. You really see that depending on the speed of the material, you're just straining a viscous system and you see this huge temperature increase locally. Some nice work was done by some researchers a while ago that also investigated this on polyacetal, so POM, with different R values and different frequencies. And if you then summarize the result, I think it's interesting and well summarizing the effects that you would expect. Because if you go to low frequencies, you see some kind of trend. And the cycles to failure is low because if you then multiply the time, these are measurements in the order of, let's say, 3-4 days, all of them. If you then increase frequency, then something strange happens, because at short times you can see the points start to deviate, but at long times they more or less overlap again. If you increase frequency even further, or even further and even further, you can still see the same trend. At long times you have some kind of trend, which is some master curve, and at shorter times you see some deviations. So what you actually have is at short term you have the effect of frequency, so you can see the self-heating effect, and depending on the frequency that you apply, this effect is more severe or less severe. But as long as the time, the load and the frequency are low, the time is long enough and the load and the frequency are low enough, then you will find some kind of isothermal fatigue performance that is actually representative for the material. If you then do this on a notch specimen, so here they plot the ligament stress, so this is the nominal stress, please be aware that locally at the notch the stress will be even higher. Then what they show is that you're actually only stressing a very small volume, whereas the remainder of the specimen is actually a lot bigger and is just a huge heat sink to get rid of the local generated heat. So you generate less heat and you also have a system that can get rid of the heat. And as a result, that allows you to apply a much higher load without having excessive heating. So here on the right, you can see that with 10 hertz, the nominal stress can even be, let's say, 20 MPa, whereas with the unnotched case, it has to be much lower than 15 MPa. So already this 30% on nominal stress level, you can apply higher when you have a certain stress concentration present. So I hope that this shows you that viscous heating will decrease the lifetime on shorter term, but for lower stress levels and longer times, all frequencies will fall on a certain master curve. And this master curve is then the isothermal or the real representative fatigue performance. And if you have a stress concentration present, heating is less severe. So what does it mean for our cause? Well, in part, actually you always have a very local stress concentration. So you always have a very localized region which is being stressed. So that means that you also just generate less heat. Another thing is that if you target a high number of cycles, that means you have to apply a low stress level. Because if you apply a high stress level, then you know that your lifetime will always be short. So the fact that your loads are lower, that means that you also allow higher frequencies without having excessive heating. So also there, you could argue, okay, also in part, less heat will be generated simply because the loads are lower. So with these two, I think it's fair to say that isothermal behavior will be representative for real parts. So you can measure at high frequencies whatever you want, but in the end, if you want to use it to predict for lifetimes of parts, you have to compensate for this to make sure that you're really probing the isothermal behavior. Because what would happen if you don't? Well, that's why I highlighted now the 5 hertz data. Let's assume you measure this grade or this material only at 5 hertz and you plot a trend line, then actually you would, I think, conveniently just use a polynomial fit and just see, okay, this is the trend that you would expect. But that would mean that for all these stress levels in between, you're easily 2 decades off in lifetime predictions, simply because you're using the self-heating data to predict isothermal behavior of a part. Probably more importantly, let's assume you're not measuring longer than 10 to the power 6 cycles, which is already, let's say, in this case, 2 or 3 days. That would mean that if you then would extrapolate, that you would actually also expect a much lower slope than you in reality see. And that is much more dangerous, because it would mean that if you then extrapolate towards longer times, so real practical application load, that you would really start to overestimate the performance, and then you might have premature failure in service. So I hope this shows you that if you're predicting part life based on accelerated tests, so let's say these high loads and high frequencies, you will have the risk of underestimating the short-term performance because of the self-heating, but you, more importantly, also have the risk of overestimating the long-term performance because of this wrong slope that you get. So this is hopefully also tackling the fourth take-home message. So accelerated tests might lead to misinterpretation of results because of heating, but also because of which failure mechanism are you addressing. Are those the ones representative for the long-term failure? So last but not least, I would like to also highlight a bit of the improved predictability, because he's spent quite some efforts recently to develop a framework to also perform lifetime predictions on part level. In view of time, I cannot not target everything, but I will just give you a glance at what the framework looked like. So you can imagine you start up with some fatigue data, so some input data to generate your material cards and fit your material model on. Then eventually, if you have this material model for which we use DMOD, you also want to have microstructural information to also capture the effect of anisotropy. Eventually, you will do a certain flow simulation to also predict the glass fiber orientation in your part. And eventually, what you then will find out is that you have to do some kind of correction, which we here call the stress concentration correction, which has to do with the sensitivity for notches. So how much volume do you have to distribute your stress on? In view of time, I will leave that one out of current presentation, but feel free to reach out to one of us if you want to know more details about this. Also, for the development of the framework, we also decided to leave out the effect of flow simulation in the beginning. So we only incorporate this when we start to validate this on part performance. So all the calibration and material data is generated on something where we know the microstructure, such that we also can properly feed the material model. So first, the fatigue data. Well, I already bored you, I think, for 45 minutes with 2 failure mechanisms. So I hopefully you all understand that these 2 are there and you have to be aware of those. But the advantage is, if you know that these are there, you can also develop models to properly capture the R-value dependency. And if you do so, then you can also model this sensitivity or mean stress sensitivity and feed that to your part prediction model. So this is what you can see here on the left. So you measure some Wöhler curves over SN curves. And what you then typically see is, depending on the R-value, you see some lifetime and some trends. We now know how these failure mechanisms are affected by R-value, so you can develop and fit the models, as you can see over there. And since we now have some description of the sensitivity of the lifetime for mean stress, we can also generate this so-called Goodman diagram. So the one that I introduced in the beginning, this easy tool for designing, we can now just model by using a certain amount of experiments. And because we understand the failure mechanisms, we need less experiments to, of course, say more eventually. Then this was the first glance at the fatigue data. If you then go to the material model, you can imagine that the microstructure is key in these kind of engineering parts. So on the left, you can see a flow simulation of the plate that we mold to then, after that, mill out a sample with certain glass fiber orientations. Because of this, let's say, biaxial stretching in the middle, you can imagine that in the core you have some kind of fibers which are then oriented perpendicular to the flow direction, or basically stretched in that direction. But you also have these 2 edges that you see, and because of the flow there, you get this highly oriented layer at these edges because you're shearing there. And therefore, for this specific plate, which is 2 millimeter thick, you will get a quite complex microstructure, which is here represented by the let's say by the orientation tensor. And the only thing that you have to keep in mind is that these different colors just represent fibers in a certain plane. So red means the fibers in the flow direction, the blue means fibers perpendicular to the flow direction, and the green ones are fibers in plane. And what you then can see is at the edges, you can see these 2 highly oriented regions, which is of course symmetric because you are looking at a plate. And in the middle, you can see that the orientation and flow direction is very low, but the orientation and perpendicular direction is very high. So you really have a skin core type of morphology where you have highly oriented fibers at the edges and perpendicularly oriented fibers in the middle. As a result of that, the material model, material behavior will also be highly anisotropic. So these are the stress strain curves that you measure, and you fit an orthotropic material model on that. You might be surprised that the stress strain curve for the zero and for the 45 degree and 90 degree are more or less overlapping in a modulus regime. But you have to keep in mind that this highly oriented core is the main thing that you will feel when you load this on 90 degrees. So this is the composite behavior, not per se the UD behavior, if you want. Then if you then look at this material model, then as a result of this orientation, you also get an homogeneous stress distribution, both due to geometrical features, but also due to local fiber orientation distribution. So you have to take this into account. When you're telling the software, this is the SN curve that I measured, you have to tell them to take into account the local stresses and the local lifetimes that you then, as a result, will get. So you have to tell it somewhere to take into account the local stresses properly, because otherwise you will never be consistent between FEA and between material model calibration. But if you do this properly, then you can also show the result of that. So I will first highlight this new representation. So I will plot the measured lifetime versus the predicted lifetime. So that means if you're having a perfect prediction, then you will have this thick line in the middle with slope 1, just saying, OK, what we predict is exactly the same as the one that we measure. Then the thinner line tells you something about plus or minus a factor 3. And the dashed line tells you something about plus or minus a factor 10 accuracy. And if you're on the left top, you're actually overestimating, because it means that your predicted lifetime is longer than the measured lifetime. And if you're on the right bottom, you're actually in a safe region. So for designing perspective, you actually want to be in this specific region. If you then do this for the injection molded tensile bars for the R-value dependency, you can see for RS minus 2, this is matching well. But also for all the other R values, you can see that overall, we can describe the R-value dependency for different measurements very well within this factor 3. Next would be the anisotropy. So just to give you a glance at the accuracy, you can see for RS minus 1 for samples with various microstructures, so an injection molded tensile bar and samples taking from the plaque with different orientations. You can see also there we can predict the inference of anisotropy also well within this factor 3. But you can see we're a bit on the safe side, but this was a choice just to make sure that also in the end we come up with a proper prediction. If we then look at R value plus anisotropy, then you can see over here that also this influence of both the microstructure and anisotropy and load ratio are captured very well. And just to summarize all the data that we have on the tensile specimens, or relatively simple ones, you can see that the model is consistent for a variety of R values as well as a variety of microstructures. So for your information, the different markers represent different R values and the colors represent different microstructures. So I hope that this gave you a glance about the material model and the microstructural information that we treat. Next would then be the flow simulation, if you then go to power predictions. So I showed you this demo bracket before. What we did is we injection molded a couple of them, and then we took a small part out of it to measure the local fiber orientation. So we just milled out this part and put it in the CT scanner, and then you measure the orientation tensor over this part. If you then compare it with the predicted one that you predict using Moltflow, then you get for Moltflow the solid lines, and for the measurement, the dashed lines. And besides this discrepancy in the middle, you can see that at the edges, actually, we are predicting it quite well. And please note that the failure location is actually at X position of 0. So actually there, we are confident that actually we can predict the glass fiber orientation well in the region where it matters. So last but not least, although I skipped the stress concentration correction, if we then go to power prediction, well, you can predict whatever you want, but eventually it only holds if you also have validation data. So what we did is we built a fixture to test this part in fatigue, and then we measured the lifetime for different applied load ratios. And here, please keep in mind, we applied a load ratio and force, it's the minimum force divided by the maximum, and then we applied a wide range ranging from 0.5 to minus 2. And this is the result, as you can see over there. If you're not going to predict lifetime, then the nice thing is that with this specific part, because of the asymmetry, if you're applying a load ratio smaller than RS minus 1, is that you then see a switch in failure location. Because you can imagine with RS minus 2, that means that you're pushing it up with quite a large load, and then eventually it starts to fail at the bottom. And with all the other loads, because of the asymmetry, you see failure at the top location. And this is well captured by the model. Next thing would then be the not only the location, but also the actual lifetime. And therefore, we have to look at local stresses. So if you look at the minimum load, so this is the load that we use to push it upwards, then you can see this hotspot, so this location 1, that you have a minimum principal stress of, let's say, minus 35 MPa. So if you apply 1500 newton, the minimum stress will be, let's say, minus 35. If you then apply 1500 newton in tension, then due to this asymmetry, also the stress locally is much higher, because the stress in the same hotspot is now 95 MPa. So this is a bit surprising. We're applying RS minus 1 and a force, but actually the R value in stress is very different. So the R value in stress, the one that determines your lifetime, does not necessarily equal your R value in force. And that is plotted over here. So here you have the R value versus the applied maximum force for the different applied macroscopic force ratios. And you can see that there are some significant differences. So you have to take this into account. No need to really pay attention on the absolute values, but just keep in mind, you have to compute the local load ratio properly to properly predict lifetime. Another thing to improve fatigue lifetime predictions is plasticity correction. This is different than plasticity controlled failure, because that is just a different failure indicator. But this is a trick to compensate for the let's say, efficiency of your simulation method. Because usually fatigue simulations are performed using a linear elastic material model. But it means that if you go to very high stress concentrations, that eventually the elastic behavior will start to deviate significantly from the elastic plastic material behavior, or actually the real material behavior of the material. So to compensate for that, you can use several correction methods. So you might know the Neuberg correction method. And we use the Glinka one, which is fairly similar, but it uses the elastic strain energy density. So it just looks for a certain equivalent plastic stress that has the same energy stored in the system. And with that, you can correct your, let's say, too high elastic computed stress towards a more realistic elastoplastic one. And the advantage is that you still have the efficiency and CPU time, so you can do a fast elastic simulation. And eventually you can also just estimate plastic strain field, so the real stress is there, and you can also compute the new local R value that results. And if you do that properly, then you get this validation. So here, again, this predicted lifetime versus the measured lifetime plot. For this part, for all the different R values. So the different colors represent different R values, and the different markers represent different mesh sizes. So what I hope that this shows is that besides the properly capturing the failure location, actually the predictions on part level are also well within this factor 10. And I think what is also important to realize is that the fact that we describe the slope well, it tells us that this R value dependency or local stress ratio dependency is also captured well. And I think even more importantly, it's also robust to mesh size. So it doesn't really matter. Of course, it matters what the mesh density is, but we have it at a quite broad range, and you still end up with reasonable predictions. So I hope that this shows you that if you do all these steps properly, that you then can reach accurate and robust predictions at part level. So that's more or less all about the framework. And I use this also a bit as a teaser, because we recently also implemented this in a commercial software package. So since we developed the framework, we decided, okay, it might be great to also enable this for our customers in an easy to use manner. And that's why we teamed up with eXtreme, so the company behind Digimod. So the software package that already allows you to properly model short fiber reinforced composites for, let's say, strength and stiffness. And they wanted to expand their portfolio to also enable accurate lifetime predictions. So with that in mind, we started a joint project to implement this. And actually, the good news is that it's already ready and available from the release in 2019, which they already released in October 2019. In that version, you will have two material cards from DSM Materials. So you have the Podiamide 6.6 that I also showed as an example in this slide deck, together with a PPA, both with 50% glass fibers in there. And that one allows you to perform structural analyses on these materials. Eventually, if you then do the FEA lifetime computations, you can do two things. You can do constant load ratio, which is convenient. If you know the stress ratio, why bother doing the recomputation? But they also have this feature which they call spatial varying load ratio. And that means that the software uses your force signal that you apply to compute the local stress ratio per element. And eventually, they have a nice interface that is easy to handle, to also work around with, that allows you to translate your computed stresses in Opicus or any other package, to translate those towards the real lifetime of the part, including the corrections like the gradient method and the plasticity correction method. So we are really excited about the fact that this is now available. So in case you feel interested in exploring it or wanted to know more, please feel free to contact us. And we're also really looking for additional validation parts to validate and hopefully challenge our predictive capabilities even further. So we would love to collaborate on that. So that's also more or less the end of the presentation. So I hope I now also told you something about the fifth take-home message, that if you properly understand what is happening and you can model this, that you can also do more with limited measurements. But I hope that I also showed you that you can also enable accurate power predictions there. So this is it. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your attention. And yeah, feel free to reach out if there are any questions.